will receive no royal salute whatsoever. And we await the moment when this glass coach, which we can see without periscopes, comes to a stop at the bottom of the steps of St. Paul's. The door opens, and for the first time, we see in all its glory that dress. The door opens.
And now here she comes. What a job getting all those yards of silk. And what a dream she looks. What a dream she looks. There is a bride any man would be happy to see coming down the aisle towards him. The dress is made of yards of ivory pure silk taffeta. It has big sleeves with deep lace flounces at the elbow. It has a very, very long train. And if you asked a little girl to draw a princess, I think she'd draw a dress just like that, with tiny bodies, tiny waist, and a great big skirt. And there she goes up the steps.
The bride is greeted by a fanfare sounded by the state trumpeters under the portico of St. Paul's. She takes her father's arm, and Earl Spencer, who was so seriously ill so recently, had a very serious cerebral hemorrhage, but who with great courage faces this day, not just with courage, but with relish and with enjoyment. Facing the long walk all through this cathedral. And that fanfare was the first notice that the bridegroom would have, that his bride had actually arrived. But he cannot know what a beautiful sight awaits him as she joins him at the altar. The procession of the bride begins, and the groom and his two supporters make their way with a longing look westward to the steps of the dais under the dome. And she is not doing as so many royal brides have done. She is not throwing the veil back, so there is an air of mystery about her as she quietly walks. This takes this longest and happiest walk she will ever take. See the picture as the bride on her father's arm